This is the overview of my talk. I will just have a couple of slides about the need of data standards. Then I will talk about the Proteomics Standards Initiative for those of you who haven't heard about it before. Then the main bulk of the talk will be devoted to the existing data standards. And then I will just finish the presentation by giving you what is ongoing work at the moment. I'm not going to get too much into the detail because I understand that this is a topic that is especially interesting for developers. If you have any doubts, questions, you can just either ask after the presentation, or if it's something more detailed, just drop me an email afterwards. Okay? So let's going to start. Basically, for those of you in the call that are mainly biologists, I'm well aware that basically, data standards are needed in bioinformatics, as standards are needed in life in general. So this is a typical example of the different sockets in the different regions in the world. And of course, if you have a small number of possibilities, with a small number of standards, data converters are feasible. And in the case of mass spectrometry-based proteomics, as you well know, those of you who are working in the field, there are really very different workflows, discovery modes, bottom-up proteomics, top-down proteomics, and targeted proteomics. And since there are many different data types that are involved, there is also the need for several data standards. And this has been the work that we have been doing in the last years in the context of the Proteomics Standards Initiative. So for those of you who don't know what the PSI is, it is a UPO initiative. So it was started in 2002 under the umbrella of UPO, the Human Proteome Organization. And what PSI does is develops data format standards for proteomics, both data representation and annotation standards. We try to involve as many people as possible, so not only software producers but bioinformaticians, but also data producers, database providers, or publishers. They have different work groups, and there is an annual meeting in March, April, every year on regular phone calls. And lately, I will also mention this at the end, because I know that some people in the consortium are working in metabolomics, there's really a closer interaction with the metabolomics community as well. This is the URL that you can visit, is the website. So the main PSI deliverables over the years have been the development of minimal information specifications, the so-called MIAPI standards, that are format independent specifications of minimum information guidelines. I'm not going to cover this in the talk. I'm going to mainly cover the formats. Usually they are XML based, but also there are now tab limited files as well. Control vocabularies, databases and tools like Bright and Proton Exchange, but I'm not going to cover them in the talk either. And also what PSI tries to do is to do as much community interaction as possible to ensure the position of data in published repositories. Also something that, because it's not going to be mentioned in the talk, there are also standards developed by the PSI that are devoted to the field of molecular interactions, but I'm not going to talk today about them either. So I'm going to focus on the data standards produced by the PSI that are used in mass spectrometry-based proteomics approaches. And as I mentioned before, this is going to be the main bulk of the talk. Something also, just before I start, that I wanted to make you aware is that usually when communities are developed in a community way, there's the typical dilemma that on one hand, data standards need to be stable to promote adoption, and on the other hand, proteomics standards in this case need to evolve very rapidly, because the data is inherently very complex, and also the experimental techniques are evolving all the time. So you always need to take this equilibrium, this balance into account when you develop standards. So what happens is that most likely the latest, hottest new technique cannot be represented by data standards, because there needs to be some time for a technique to be mature before data standards are developed for these techniques. So these are the five data standard formats developed by the PSI that are devoted to mass spectrometry. I will go through them: MCTAP, TRIML, MCQuantML, MCLNTML, MCML. The first one that I'm going to talk about is MCML. So just to give you, people who work in proteomics know about this already, but MCML is located in this area, so and can represent the information that is available in the raw files that are produced by the different vendors, the different mass spectrometers, and also can represent the information that is available in PIC-LIS. So in a way, this MCML data format can represent raw data, but also PIC-LIS data as well. So MCML really represents an example of a success story. It's a data format for the storage and exchange of mass spectrometry output files. It was originally designed by merging the best aspects of two data formats that were available before, MCData and MCXML. MCXML is still widely used because there's a lot of software that was produced a few years ago and is still making use of this format. It was developed with full participation of academic researchers, it was software vendors, etc. And again, it's expected to fully replace MCXML and MCData, but it takes some time for its adoption. It captures mainly spectra, raw data, or PIC-LIS, as I mentioned before, but also it can capture chromatograms and all the related metadata. The stable version is the version 1.1 that was released in June 2009, so as you can see, a few years ago already. And really many implementations exist. The original publication was published in NCP in 2011, and it really represents the example of success story, and there are a lot of implementations out there. A lot of software that is open source. Probably the most popular one is ProteoWizard that enables the conversion from raw files from different vendors into MCML, but there are also Java libraries, there are bioconductor libraries, etc., etc. In this URL, you can have the list of implementations of MCML. The second data standard format that I was going to mention is also getting more and more widely used, is MCIdentML. And it's an XML-based data standard for peptide and protein identifications. So, for instance, to capture all the parameters and all the results following database search and protein inference. It can capture information for protein spectrum matches, protein groups, protocols, parameters, basically everything that needs to be captured to represent fully a spectrum search containing only identification data, though. So it's only for identification data. The manuscript was published in NCP in 2012. This is the full reference. The version 1.1 was again the stable one and was released already more than 4 years ago. And in the last year, as we have also been working in trying to develop the version 1.2 that I will mention later. It really has an increasing number of implementations. So I would say that now a big proportion of the most popular software in the field can export MCIdentML 1.1, commercial software like Mascot and Protein Pilot and Scaffold and PIX. And also, of course, more academic or open source software like Xtandem or the TPP, although it's not so easy from the TPP at the moment, OpenMS, and MSGF Plus, and other search engines. And thanks to this, really to the development of MCML and MCIdentML, it has been possible to standardize at least identification and mass spectra data in proteometry repositories. And it has been really very useful in the further development of proteome exchange. There are tools that don't output the standards, like for instance Andromeda, MaxQuant, also MaxQuant especially for quantification, but we are getting there. The next standard that I wanted to mention is for quantification information mainly. It's called MCQuantML. Again, it's an XML-based standard for quantification data following the use of quantification software. And it really has a very flexible data model that can report quantification at very different levels. and all these different levels can be encoded as quant layers in the schema. I'm not going to get too much into the details. It can also capture all the features, not only the final results. The first version of the standard, the version 1.0, was released in February 2013, so now almost 3 years ago. And it supported level 3 intensity and spectral counting, MS2-based tag techniques like iTrack or TNT, or MS1 level techniques like SILAC. But the schema is fixed, with each technique defined by a separate set of semantic rules. The manuscript was published in NCP in 2013. This is again the full reference. And then it was updated in 2014. Actually, the manuscript was published in just last year, in 2015, to support selected reaction monitoring as a new technique. And actually, the version of the format 1.0.1 was just approved, I think, a couple of days ago. So I didn't change the slide. The version 1.0.1 was approved by the PSI a couple of days ago. There are not too many implementations of the standard so far, I have to say. I want to highlight this library called MCQ Library. This is produced by the group of Andy Jones in the University of Liverpool. It was published recently in Proteomics, although I realized that I forgot to put the reference. Anyway, you go in PubMed and look for MCQ Library, you will find it. The next data format that I want to mention here is MCTAP that we develop. We led the development here at the ABI. And the idea was really because the previous formats that I've been talking about, MCML, MCADentML, MCQuantML, they can really capture all the information that is needed to reproduce the analysis of identification or quantification data, but we thought that also it was a good idea just following the trend set up in transcriptomics, for instance, to provide a simpler format for enabling the report of a summary of the experimental results. So we developed this originally aiming to support peptide and proteins, but also small molecules. We consider small molecules from the beginning, and of course to be able to report technical and biological metadata as well. The idea was, of course, to make a format that it was easier to parse and used by the research community, not only the proteomics community, but also potentially systems biologists, as well as providers of knowledge bases or biological databases. It does not aim to replace MCML and MCQuantML, because although it can contain really a big subset of the metadata included in those formats, it will not represent the full trace. It will not enable the full reproducibility of the analysis. NCTAP has a present 5 sections in the version 1.0. That is the version that is now stable. It was published in a bit more than 1 year ago in NCP. You can also see the publication here. And it has different sections, metadata, that is based on key value pairs, and then different tables, one for protein, another one for peptide, another one for PSM, another one for a small molecule, because again, from the beginning, we wanted to consider mass spectrometry metabolomics approaches as well. So this is just an example to see the metadata section. You can see that not only is computer readable, it can only be made human readable as well. There are different implementations, not too many. So we develop also the JMCTAP library. That is a Java library open source that can deal with the format. And at the moment, there are other tools that produce it, or in producing the format, like Mascot, for instance. Masquant, we have had a sport in beta for a very long time, but we have not managed to finish it. And also OpenMS, and there are also lipidomics tools like this tool, Lipidic Analysis, that also output the format. Also, there are colleagues here at the ABI from the Metabolites database that are aiming to use the format, but still is not yet fully there. I will mention again metabolomics at the end of the talk. And the last of the main data standards that are used is that are developed by the PSI is called DRAML. Is aimed as for SRM, selective reaction monitoring approaches. Again, is DRAML means transitions markup language. Is a format for encoding SRM and MRM transitions, and the version 1.0 was released and published in NCP in 2012. And it has been stable. The format is much simpler than others. So this schema really is much simpler than, for instance, MCLNTML and MCQuantML. And is it has been implemented in different tools. And there's also a Java library called JDRAML that was developed a few years ago to deal with the format, also to trigger the development of converters. And also, before I forget, I also wanted to mention that DRAML can also be adapted for small molecules as well. So I will mention it again at the end. All these five data formats, what they have in common is that, together with other data formats that are developed by the PSI, is that all of them went through a thorough review process that is similar to the review process of a manuscript. Usually it takes longer because, well, these specifications can be quite complex to review, and also you need to have different iterations. So at the end, what happens in practice, and what has happened for us in practice, is that actually there are two review processes happening in parallel: the PSI one and the manuscript review. And so that ensures that the quality and the quality of the standard is quite good at the end. I also wanted to mention that in all these data standards, all these data standards make a heavy use of the PSI MS control vocabulary. Here you have a screenshot of just an OVO file viewer. It's developing in the OVO format, and it was published in the journal database in 2013. And it's updated quite often. Lately, not that much, but actually, yes, it's updated regularly. And if you are, you can be subscribed to the mailing list in order to see all the updates. What I meant is that before the updates were bigger in terms of new terms added, now maybe the updates are happening as often as before, but not so many new terms are added every time. This work is led by Gerhard Meyer in the University of Bochum in Germany. Okay, so I just wanted to finish this section talking about the importance of making software available that can deal with these data standards. So we have developed over the years different reference libraries in Java that are always open source. So we led here in the team the development of JMCML, JMCLNTML, together with Andy Jones group in Liverpool, JMC Reader, and JMC Tag, and JMC QuantML was led by the Andy Jones group in Liverpool. But we have also been working here, and if you are working with data standards, I would recommend you to give a try to the tool, is the Pride Inspector tool that was published originally in 2012, but actually in this issue, this month's issue of NCP, the second version is published, and it's really a very nice visualization tool, open source, everyone can use it, that can deal with many of these standard formats, MCLNTML, plus all types of spectra files, MCML, MCTAP, and also the original Pride data format, Pride XML. So it's really a very nice tool. I don't have time to explain here many of these features, but I just recommend you to give it a try. You can download it in this URL. Just to finish the talk, I wanted to mention, in case you are interested, some of the work that is already ongoing. And the first part that I have mentioned several times already in the talk is that we are working together with some people of the metabolomics community to adapt some of the formats to mass spectrometry metabolomics approaches. In this sense, they are mainly interested in MCML and MCTAP. Both of them can be used already. And also DRAML, as I mentioned, and MCQuantML, I didn't mention this, can also, at least they can support the storage of small molecule information there, although they haven't been used for this aim yet. So the community, the metabolomics community, is focusing, as I mentioned, MCML and MCTAP. In the first case, in MCML, it's really widely used already by different vendors, and there are already a few converters available. Basically, what happened is that new CV params needed to be added in order to support gas chromatography approaches, but ProtoWizard works also well, so actually MCML, after a few adjustments, has been is increasingly adopted by the metabolomics community. But for the results, identification and quantification results, there is no data standard. They didn't have any data standard yet, so they started working with MCTAP, with and his work has been led by Stefan Neumann in Germany in the framework of the COSMOS EU-FP7 project that finished a couple of months ago, that has been led by our colleagues here of the Metabolites group. So this work is ongoing, it's not finished, but the idea is that MCTAP in the future will be able not only to represent properly proteomics, but also small molecule related results. I forgot to mention that in the first version we already included one section to represent this, but of course that's not enough to represent all the data the way they wanted to do it, so that's why they are now extending the format. We are also working in the extension of MCL-NTML to version 1.2 in order to support PTL localization score, like for instance phosphorylation, support for petal level statistics, or multiple search approaches in the same file. And what is still not finished is support for cross-linking approaches. And it seems that the next meeting in Ghent, I will mention that, there will be a selected group of people trying to get this finished. So there is already a publication about version 1.2 of the standard that was published in proteomics. And also something that we are working now is in the standardization of formats that are aimed at proteogenomics approaches, and we are working in the development of the proband format, its adaptation of the bandsum format. The work has been led by Xiaoxiang Wang, in the University of Vanderbilt. They published a paper in MCP recently, but the format was not yet formalized, and we are working on that formalization. And we are also doing the formalization of that ABET format for peptides. And the idea, of course, of all these two formats is a different level, being able to represent proteomics, PSN at genomics level, like it happens for RNA-seq with the BAM format. And that's it. I'm about to finish. I just wanted to mention that if someone is interested in attending the PSI meeting, you can go to the website, and it will happen next year in Ghent, in Belgium. This year already, here in 2016, from the 18th to the 20th of April. Attendance is free. You will need to pay, of course, for your travel and accommodation, but attendance is free of charge, so anyone can really attend. And that's it. I really wanted to acknowledge all contributors to the PSI activities, and there are really too many to cite here. And especially because they have been more involved lately, Andy Jones and Eric Deutsch, who is the PSI chair. And also all the people involved in the COSMOS grant due to the extensions of the formats to the MS Metabolomics community. And I also want to acknowledge the PSRC. And that's basically it. I'm open for questions.
This is Andrew. Maybe I'll start with like a social question, right? I think the oldest standard you presented was MZML. Is that right?
Sorry, I didn't understand the first part of your question.
Is the oldest standard you presented was MZML? I think it was 2008, 2009, something like that.
So I was presenting not only MZML, I was presenting also the other.
No, the oldest. Yes, the oldest one is
okay.
Was MZML, yes.
Yes.
And I think you mentioned that it has a good adoption, but it's still partial adoption. And I guess I'm wondering, 5-6 years down the road, Or, oh, sorry, even more than that, right? 6 or 7 years down the road. I mean, you know, from a community standpoint, is it just inertia? Is it people feel that there are certain edge cases that aren't well represented by MZL? What is it going to take for, you know, full community adoption?
So I think it's more a matter of practicability, because the problem is that there are a lot of software that was produced by labs that were dealing with MCXML, and that software was developed many years ago, and just because for them it's easier, and as you know, the resources are scarce sometimes. Sometimes labs continue working with MCXML because it's just easier for them to do, and I would say that that's the main obstacle to a higher adoption of the format. From a practical point of view, I think that the adoption will only increase. MCXML is quite can be quite ugly to work with. MCML is much more flexible, and also the problem, but also it has problems. So MCML has problems with big raw files, like for instance iMobility or the Swath data, and that makes the files that are extremely big. These cases were not there when the format was originally developed, and that's why at some point compression will need to be tackled in a proper way in MCML. That's the idea already there, but it hasn't been tackled yet. So yeah, as I said, for normal shotgun data, I think that adoption will only increase. It's just a matter of getting the resources to do it, because it's a much nicer format than MCXML. For Swath, iMobility is not an optimal solution. Let's say it this way.
We can go back to the initial slide. In old houses, you can still find the old socket types, even if now there has been, let's say, a new standard for 20 years. It's a bit misusing the image, but there is just, as you said, some inertia. And in all the standards we have been active in, there's never 100% adoption. There's always, perhaps if you're good, then you catch half of the community.
Got it. Thank you.